Okay, so next meeting is on 3D printers as a general topic. And of course, this one is specific. I picked this up right after Thanksgiving, or around Thanksgiving, I forget when it was. So I've only got a couple months usage of it. But what it's been able to do is just fascinating. A very handy gadget. So I put together a quick PowerPoint presentation that'll cover 3D printers in general, how they work, some of the things it takes to utilize them. And in front of here are some of the things I printed on here. You could either design your own with a CAD program, which most of this has been done in CAD. A few things are downloadable from a few websites and printed. This is one of the test prints that it does. This was downloaded and printed. This is a little vibration dampener foot. Here's a vibration isolation mount for a flight controller. The rest of it was all done in CAD. My own designs and printed. The quad here was originally a download print I modified. Changed some few things on it. That's one of the beauties of it. You can download and modify to suit what you need. Okay, so to get started with the presentation, everybody can see that okay?
Yeah.
Great. All right, so this is how a 3D printer can help you out. Okay, there's really a little drawing there. It says, how does a 3D printer work? I've got a paper version of it that I'll reference. Basically, step one is you come up with a 3D image using a computer-aided design package or CAD. Step two, the CAD file is sent to the printer. It's a little more than that, but for beginning, we'll just go with that. So once the printer receives the drawing that it's going to print, it uses specific motors to move on the X and Y axis. And we'll move around and put the build onto the plate. And as it gets more plastic put down, the plate drops down and builds it vertically. So what they're talking about here is the axis move around and lays down the successive layers of plastic. Some of the printers do powder, some do paper, some do wood, some do metal. So depending on what type of printer you have, this particular printer does plastic.
Wait, what do you mean they do powder and what do you mean they do wood?
Well, that'll be coming up in a second here.
Okay,
so the types of printers. There is the extrusion wire, which is what this is. It's called a filament. If you look at the back side, you'll see these two spools of plastic filament wire, which are, they're 1.75 millimeter. The other types are granular powder. There's some printers that could use that. There's also laminated printers, which I've never really seen one of those, but it's listed. And then the light polymerized, which is a resin bath printers. You've probably seen those on YouTube where it comes up out of the liquid. Okay, so those are the basic types of printers. For the hobby market, extrusion wire is what you're gonna have, which is what this is. So it takes this 1.75 millimeter plastic and through heat and whatnot, melts it down to a 0.4 millimeter. And that's what it builds all this with. It just layers, successive layers of that on there. Okay, the filament materials, this is the materials that you can load onto your printer to print with. The two main plastics are PLA and ABS. That's probably 90-some percent of what everybody uses. This particular plastic is PLA plastic. It's the easiest to use, and it's pretty tough stuff. You can come up and kind of bend on this stuff. You see how hard it is. ABS is what most of the printers were using until recently. PLA is kind of a newer material. And it's actually a whole lot easier than ABS was. ABS takes more heat. So there's advantages with the PLA. The disadvantage of PLA, it's known to be brittle and hard. I've not really seen that, but I guess if you crash your quad, it'd probably break it pretty easy. ABS is much softer and pliable. In my experience, it tends to fall apart a lot easier. There's also a nylon material that you can purchase. I have not tried that. That takes even more heat than the ABS does. They have food grade plastics. So you could actually make your cereal bowl or spoons or whatever you want. They have Woodfield. I have not utilized that. Of some of the internet forums that I've read that follow that, it comes out kind of looking like the real cheap cardboard and some of the packing things you've probably purchased over the years. But it smells like wood when you're printing it. PET Plus Flexible, which is a flexible material. You can actually build something and bend it when it's done. It's real flexible. They also have some ceramics and metals that they're working on. One of them I saw was actually they embedded carbon fiber into the filament. Haven't seen how that really works. And there'll be new ones coming out. The market's fixing to take off. I read the other day they said by, I think it was 2018, they expected to be like a $500 million market for material. Matter of fact, even what Radio Shack and Walmart are selling printers now.
How much is yours cost?
This particular one, Amazon sells it for $1,100. You can find them cheaper. There is a few differences in it. Okay, the parts of the 3D printer. There's a device called the print bed, which is this bed right here. And what that is, most of the time they're heated, sometimes they're unheated. With PLA, you could actually do it without any heat. But getting it to stick down is somewhat of a problem, depending on what material you're using on the bed. It's basically the platform where everything's beaded, built. This one is heated. The particular bed on here is aluminum plate. It has a captain tape covering, which traditionally has been used for ABS plastics. It does work with most of the PLA plastics. There's a few that I have issues with. The other thing that I do is put down the blue printer's tape, masking tape, and it sticks real good to that. Some guys put a glass plate down and they cover it with hairspray and some of the stick glues and stuff like that. Whatever you can to get it to stick. That's the trick. Second part of the 3D printer is the extruder. The extruder is what feeds the plastic to the hot end, where it oozes out. Some printers only have a single extruder. This one has dual. So you can run two different colors of plastics or even two different materials if you wanted it at the same time. These devices up here are the extruders. There's little stepper motors that actually grab the plastic and shove it down into the hot piece where it melts it. Or the hot end, they call it. Okay, the hot end is right below the extruder. That's the part that has the heater and the temperature sensor. And that's where the material is melted down and then it comes out through a nozzle. Nozzle sizes, really it's 0.1 millimeter up to 1.3 actually, are the typical sizes. Most of the industry is using a 0.4 nozzle, which is what this is. And then the plastic filament is similar to the ink in your inkjet printers. That's what's on the spools in the back. And that's what it's going to melt down and build your prints with. Okay. Now, some of the concepts that you run into in these printers is, yes, you have a CAD program that defines your 3D object, but to get it to the printer, it has to be into a format that the printer can speak. And that goes through a piece of software called a slicer. So what the slicer does is look at the 3D model and figure out how to start stacking the object as it builds it. There's several different slicing engines that are used. Typically, you find one that works and you stick with it. And they'll be covered up here in a second. Matter of fact, here they are. The three main slicers are the MakerBot slicer, which this is a clone of the MakerBot, so the MakerBot slicer works great with it, and it's the easiest to use. There's also one called the SkyForge, which is in the Replicator program. That one really isn't really developed much anymore. It's an old one. But the only thing that's used for is for loading firmware, although you can use it for building 3D prints. And then SLIC3R, that's an open source version of Slicer. Some of the guys are using that. I haven't tried that one yet. But again, all the Slicer does is take your solid design and split it into the commands for the printer to layer it out. Another concept is layer height, which is how much plastic you're putting down to build your model. It's equivalent to the vertical resolution in 3D printers. It's typically defined in millimeters. And the problem with small layers is that they make your build take longer for every layer you print. Say at a layer height of 0.3 millimeter, you have to print three layers, each one taking just as much time if you're printing at 0.1. So depending on what you're printing, this type of stuff, you go with 0.3. When you're getting down to fine detail, you drop it down to 0.1. So it's how much detail you want per slice. Again, standard nozzle size on most printers is 0.4 millimeter these days. And again, if you look at what I extruded out, this is roughly the size that you get. You want to pass it around if you want to. And that could be made bigger or larger depending on the nozzle and the type of extruder material you're using. Okay, another concept is build speed, which is how fast you're putting this stuff down. And that's determined by the feed rate. So the feed rate is the speed at which your extruder is pushing the plastic through, and that's determined by the stepper motor extruders. And he's talking about, see, best to set both same speed. Making sure. Anyway, that's adjustable in the software. Typically, you can leave it at defaults, which we'll do some prints here in a minute. I'll show you that. So the trade-off with speed, build speed, is between the fast speed and the high object quality is the faster the build, the more rough the texture becomes. So when you really want to fine detail, you slow it down and let it take its time. Some of these prints can take a while. This was at least 3 hours to do that one. That's at defaults. So if you get into a finer printout, that could take 6-9 hours, quite a while. Most things take half hour to an hour, roughly, to print. Some are longer. Yes?
Does it require a constant, like in a traditional paper printer, right, where there's a data feed going on most of the duration of the print? Is that file dumped in its entirety to the printer?
No, it's in little sections. This particular one's based on our Arduino 1280 chip, which doesn't have a whole lot of memory. So
it's got to have that constant, throughout the 4 or 5, so you know what your PC going through.
Right, so it's a lot like a CNC machine. You keep feeding it the data.
Okay.
Although, what's cool about this one is it has a little slot over here that you can put an SD card on it and put your image there and say print from the card. Where did the slot went to? I'm not sure if they all have that, but most of the MakerBot clones have that. Okay, also build times can vary depending on what type of material you're using too. Some of the materials you want to go real slow. Okay, the other concept is going to be in temperatures. Again, depending on the material, you have different temperatures you're going to be using. And the thing I found out here in the last month is also depending on the color of materials affects your temperature. Some of the colors have different rates. So some of the guys that's been in this for years mentioned in the forums that pretty much every print you do is going to be different than the last one. And so far I can agree with that. Best colors I've had is the red and the green seem to work the best. The yellows and the blues are the harder ones. And the white's kind of a hard one too. So different plastics melt at different temperatures. And of course, it's all the same plastic material, but they add additives and colors, and that affects the properties. They're also temperamental about moisture and water content. So when the summer gets here, I'm gonna have to figure out a way to keep these things airtight, keep the water out. The PLA melts at about 180 degrees, which is about right, yeah. Translucent colors, clear when it's extruded at higher temperatures. The ABS takes a much higher temperature, 215 or better centigrade. Oh, okay. Higher build speeds require higher temperature extrusions because you're laying down more plastic, so you want it melted quicker. use a temperature 220 for ABS and PLA, a speed of about 40 millimeter per second. At 230, the speed's up to about 100 millimeters. Again, the more you play with this, the more you pretty much figure out what speed and what temperature you're going to be running your things at. And so that's always going to be adjusted as you do these. Also, the build plate temperatures, depending on the material. Like I said, for PLA, I typically run it about 60 degrees centigrade, although you can, if I put like the blue tape down, just turn it off, leave it cold. So it depends what you're doing to have it stick. ABS, of course, takes much higher temperatures on the build plate. It'll stick without the high temp, but then it'll start warping on you. So you want it hot so it stays flat. Another concept is shells and infill. If you had a chance to look at this, you'll see the bottom is honeycombed. What happens is your 3D model is sitting at a solid object. But you don't want to print it solid. You're wasting a lot of plastic if you don't need it. So they have a thing called infill, which determines what percentage of solid you want it to be. So in this particular case, this is printed at 10%, which is the default. So what he does is build a honeycomb structure inside to represent the solid. And that's basically adjustable from really 0 to 100%. Typically, nobody goes over 80%. Most of the things I build, this was 20%. So you'll see it has a smaller honeycomb pattern in it. And still very strong. And then shells is basically the width of the walls you're making. So whatever that is, that determines how many, what the width of the wall is going to be. So if you leave it at default, he's like one thread thick. If you go to two or three, then it'll extend to two or three threads thicker. So again, depending on what you're building, you may need to change that. Typically, anywhere from 0 to 3 is typically where you're at. At least everything I've done so far. So typically 10% is the default, and one or two shells is about all you really use. And again, as you get onto it, you can play with that, see if it works better for you. Okay, the design tools, this is where it gets hairy. The printer itself is pretty straightforward. All you need to learn is some of the concepts, speeds and temps and the material. When you get into the design tools, that's where your headache becomes. There are a lot of options out there. Some of them are free, other ones are thousands of dollars. There's a few free ones that are pretty decent to use, and we'll cover those as part of this. But Autodesk, AutoCAD is probably the big one out there. There's some free ones. Blender is an open source project. One of my favorites is Tinkercad. It's a website free CAD program. And we'll bring that up and show you. Other ones are commercial solid CAD programs. SolidWorks is another option. It's pretty big. Some of those I never heard of, like Mudbox. Anyway, it's kind of, you just need to try different programs, see which one you can figure out fairly easy and which one works for you. Or you can spend a lot of money and figure it out the hard way. Some of the programs are free for betas for a limited time. It's like I've got a version of AutoCAD through my son who's in college, so that was a free version to use for a few years. There's different options there. So the next thing is 3D printing. What's next? Currently, we're doing things like this, parts for our hobby, copters, airplanes, you know, little trinkets here and there. Some of the other things we're working on, you've seen YouTube where they have working guns. I would not do it with this type printer. This has no real structural strength to it. Most of those are done on the resin printers, and that's where you basically have a tub full of resin and has a laser that shoots down there and molecularly puts the plastics together and then extrudes it up. That's a lot stronger material. Of course, the strongest is injection molding, where it's built under pressure. This is just layered, so do not build a gun. They're doing some stem cell printing now. You've probably seen some reports of that on TV, where they're actually going out and putting down human cells to build organs or whatever. So we expect that in the next couple years. The bionic ear, they can make those. You've probably seen the news articles on TV over Christmas where the guy was doing a mechanical hand for his son. Anybody see that? That's an open source project, so you can download that and print it. There's also a concept for 3D printing a lunar base. Go figure.
Just in case.
You know, really, it's amazing once you get this, what you can really do with it. Example, I downloaded this little gadget last night, which is a little protective case for one of the OpenPilot Revos. and the board was loose inside, needed some spacers. So I measured it real quick, needed roughly about a 9mm spacer. And I checked my supplies, I had 5 and 15, so whip out CAD and make the spacer custom size for what you need and print it out. It took 8 minutes. So problem solved. Handy gadgets. I hear it again. Okay, here's some useful internet sites. There's a site called Thingiverse. That's the main site where you can go and download all these free designs that you can print. A lot of this stuff came from there. Well, several things did. And of course, Tinkercad is the online CAD program. Let's see if I can turn my phone on and get internet. I'll show you Tinkercad while that's running. Yeah, where'd it go? There it is. FlashForge is the company that builds this. They have a website. Again, this particular printer is a clone of the MakerBot replicator. And this is made out of China. It's probably the number one 3D printer coming out of China these days. I think they make 400 or 500 of these a day now. The website, Just PLA, was where I ended up buying the printer and the materials. It's a U.S. company. There's several that sell material. There's another site called NetFab. What that particular site does is you go to Thingiverse, download your file that you're going to print, and most of the time it won't print. There's usually some issues with them. So you can upload it to NetFab, and it will fix the file and let you download it again. So if you get one that doesn't print right, try that site. And of course, MakerBot guides have a lot of instructions, how-tos, troubleshooting, things like that. I guess that's it. Okay. So I'll bring up Thingiverse in a minute, but let me do a quick print.
Make something.
Let's go make something.
Cost of materials, like
Sure. These particular rolls are, I think they're 2-pound rolls. If you go back, you can see how big it is. I have yet to use one of these. They last forever. But a single roll is $30 shipped. If you buy three, then he drops the price. So you can do that. Get this thing. All right, so we're going to build. Let me just build the standoffs that I made. That's quick. So away it goes. First thing I'll do is put all the bed down and home the axis. Okay, so that's been done. So the next thing he's doing is heating. Currently he's heating the bed to 30 degrees or 60 degrees centigrade. So he'll do that first. Then once that's done, he'll start the extruder heating.
Now,
it'll just take a few minutes.
If you're heating the bed, why do you have that fan?
Because PLA needs to cool pretty quick. Cool. Again, the bed is to stick it.
Right.
I turn the fan on to cool it.
Okay.
So it's kind of doesn't make sense, but it works.
Does the fan come on automatically?
No. There is a way in the software to do that, but I couldn't figure it out. So I just put a 12-volt power supply in with a 12-volt fan and made a switch. And I have a little light I put on, too.
Okay.
Yeah, first mod.
You added that, yeah.
Yes.
So it's heating the bed.
Right now he's heating the bed. He's at 44 degrees and coming up.
What's his name?
I have no clue. Printer.
Creator.
Let me bring up Thingiverse here, or Tinker.
Now while you're pulling that up, what did you say again about that Netflix or not Netflix?
NetFab?
NetFab.
Okay, when you go to Thingiverse, let me bring a web up, I'll show you. That would work. Yeah, I'm gonna do that. Obviously, I got the wrong thing. Verse. Never works when you type it in, does it? Okay, let's just go to one that's already open. This is Thingiverse, and what it has is just thousands of designs out there you can explore. So we can say things, and it just brings a whole bunch. So you just find whatever you want and download it. The other thing you can do is go to the top. We'll just say quad. So show me the quads.
Oh yeah, on quad frames.
Yeah. So there's one there. You click on it, and there's what it looks like. And it's got a little button that says download this thing. But if you click on the actual files, you'll see that it's spider_h-quad.stl. STL is a stereolithographic file, which is what the printer's slicer programs take and convert into commands for the printer. So an STL file is a 3D print file, typically. Again, if you download that and print it and it doesn't come out exactly right, you can take that STL file and upload it to the NetFab site, and it will go through it and fix it and let you be able to download the fixed version. So Thingiverse is just gobs of stuff out there. And do I have Tinkercad? No. Okay, so now he's gonna start printing. A lot of times you don't need the fan, but it makes it a little easier. What he does at first, he lays down just a line to clean out the nozzle, and he'll start printing. In this particular print with spacers, he just goes in circles. Oh, they're down again. Spacers. That looks like Tinkercad's offline again. They've been having issues the last couple days. So in the meantime, I want to show you MakerWare. This is the program that you use to take your STL file and make something. So I'll open. Let's just say some of the stuff I've done. So here's one of the quad mini arms I started out with. This is one that I downloaded. So this is what it is laying on the virtual bed of your printer. In this particular one, since we have dual color, you're allowed to assign it to the left or right extruder, which I have white in the left, and well, it was blue, but it's green now. Green in the right. There's a way to change that. Green is. Green. Okay, so now it's green. So that kind of matches the colors. So you basically load your STL file. You're allowed to view it. You can move it around if you want to. So you can actually determine where to build it on the bed. You can also flip it around, so you can move things that way.
Will it choose what to bring down first?
Well, that's one little secret of these things, is you need a flat bottom. example. Okay, so if I go here, you see that he's got this space underneath. That won't print. So there is a way to do that, is when I tell it to make the file, it has a thing on the side here. First, we're selecting the ABS or PLA. It has a thing called rafts and supports. So if I hover over supports, he mentions that the build plastic supports to hold up the pieces of the model that are in the air, basically. So you could build it upside down and use supports. The problem is with PLA, it's really a pain getting those supports off. It's really like kind of like cardboard. You're building it up on the edges, how it's wavy patterns. That's what it does under the actual print. But PLA sticks so well, you can spend an hour cleaning that thing up. ABS, I've done it a few times, it just rips right off. So typically you want it as flat as you can to build things. That's like this particular piece here, when I build it, it actually builds this way. And the first couple times I tried it, all I got was melted blobs, and I couldn't figure out why. Then I found out about supports that builds an actual structure under it so we can actually print that. But typically you want it to be flat if you can. So that's what that is. There's also a thing called rafts, which is kind of like a pallet, even before the model prints.
So on those, you cut the supports off after you're done building it?
Yeah, but like I said, the PLA is really hard to get those off. On some of the ABS, it comes right off, but you will spend some time getting those off if you have to use those. So most of the things I print, I try and make them flat. Okay, so now our spacers are done. I think it takes about 8 minutes to do that. You should tell us at the end here. Yeah, about 8 minutes. So now we have four spacers. Drop one. And sometimes getting the prints off of the bed is interesting. There you go.
Burn your fingers. Are they threaded on the inside or?
No, they're just regular spacers, hollow. I don't have the CAD program here. I'd show you what they look like.
Any other head consumable, anything other than kind of the plastic?
No, just when it breaks.
Like, I mean, you could print for a couple years, and realistically, with modern use.
Well, I haven't had it that long, but from what I can tell, they're pretty reliable.
Okay.
The motors will break, the belts will break, the extruders will eventually clog up. You got to clean them every now and then. The hot ends can get clogged.
Designed to go, go out and. Or have to be replaced, let's say?
Not that I know of, no. It depends on the printers. Eventually they'll wear out. They all will, because it does a lot of printing, a lot of moving. Oh, it's amazing. I mean, on the red one, I'm down about that much, and I've printed tons of stuff.
You talked a lot about the need to have high heat. Is it difficult to have high heat? Or maintain the high heat on the nylon?
No, they'll do it. When you get into nylons, a lot of guys will actually seal these up so you have a closed system that'll hold the heat in. Being open like this, you probably wouldn't do nylon very well. Yeah, it's amazing how strong the PLA is. Anyway, so let me close this real quick and I'll show you. I gotta select the object first. Select. Turn. Okay. So let me get him back to the flat side down. Okay, so if we wanted to, let's say we wanted to print this particular thing here, then we'll go into make. It has a USB port is what it talks to the computer with. So if it's hooked up, you have an option to make it now. Since we don't have it hooked up, our option is export to a file, which is typically on the SD card.
Will it make props too?
I tried that once, and they're really too thin to be practical. Otherwise, it would be great. yeah. So what I'm going to do here is tell it I want to do it in PLA plastic. Then we drop down to different profiles. Just do the standard for now. So notice our infill is set at 10%, which is adjustable to whatever we want. So we'll just make it, say, 20%. The number of shells, one or two, we'll just say one. Our layer height, again, it's pretty much up to 0.4, but typically 0.3 is kind of the default. That's how thick we want the layer to be. Then we go to temperature. Again, depending on what plastic you're using, you'll know what temperature you use. Typically 200 degrees works pretty good on PLA. We'll heat the bed, and I usually do about 60 degrees centigrade for the bed. And you have the speeds. Default is set for 90 millimeters per second when it's extruding, travel rate of 150. That's fine for now. And there is a way to go in and modify all this. I haven't really done it yet. Actually, let me hook it up. We'll try that real quick. I'll get one started and show you what it looks like on a bigger print.
I presume that the largest continuous print you can do is the size of the bed.
Yes. And this particular bed is, I believe it was 8 inches by 6 inches, and it'll do about a 5 foot height or 5 inch height, somewhere in that range. Let's see, everything's still the same. No, it resets everything. Okay, so we'll make it. So what is it doing now is slicing it, which is, again, where it takes the 3D design and turns it into the different layers. This is the MakerWare software, which is much quicker than the other one I use, which it comes with the RepG software. So when I went to MakerWare, it's a whole lot easier. Yeah, they really have. When you get into dual color, he actually builds rafts, which are little blocks that come up, and he wipes the different plastic over it as he goes between colors, so you don't get the colors mixed up. Because you always have a little bit of stuff dangling. There's the little piece that lays down to clean out the hot end. So again, he's gonna go back into the heating routine. He'll heat the bed and then heat the extruder.
You don't ever have to clean off the extruder?
Oh yeah, eventually you do. Matter of fact, there was a Thingiverse design I had up there. It's a little plastic ring that you drive the extruder down in when it's hot, and it leaves the charged stuff on it. I haven't cleaned this one yet. It probably needs it. Yeah, it's getting a little charred. Oh, any questions while we're waiting on this?
Is it changing the program when you do different extruders of different sizes? Or do you have to compensate for that? Remember you were saying something about...
Yeah, whenever you make a change, you'll have to go into the program and change defaults.
Right. Well, I mean, you were saying you can use different tips. So I guess the thicknesses of plastic that comes out?
Yeah. So I mean, the smaller the tip...
So that's all in the setup process.
Right. I mean, your layers will be smaller at that point.
That ultimately would change everything.
Right. I mean, you can get into the actual settings of this, and there's hundreds of things you can adjust. And like I said, I went into it once, looked at it, and said, not yet.
Is your printer receiving the signal from the computer or from internet?
Right now it's coming from the computer. That's some stuff I had stored on there. What that really is the original version of that I downloaded. And I'd end up taking that and molding them together. Rather than have a quarter as I did in halves. Matter of fact, I think I have the original printout I did. Yeah. So that's what this comes out like. Well, it's a little modified from that, but
it's a quarter, right?
Yeah. That's the original.
You bolt it together with little bolts.
They bolt together, yes.
Rod, on something like this where you know, you're going from one flat plane to a long span. How did you do that? How did it print that? It was like, I'm assuming if you printed it from the bottom right there, it drew four circles.
Yeah, if I were to do it again, I would do that. But when I did that one, I didn't know better.
Yeah.
So it was actually orientated with the tips down.
Like
that. Okay. So like I said, the first couple times I tried printing it, all I got was blobs of plastic getting dragged all over the place.
Because once it tries to span, for example, from here over to here, it just falls down and melts.
Well, again, it starts at the bottom, so those little tips is all it was trying to lay down. And there wasn't enough to stick it. No, the actual bottom.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Thinking slices.
Okay, what I'm talking about is as it's building up,
yes,
it gets to a point where you've got four of these little legs, and then it has to draw one line that goes clean across from here to here.
Mm-hmm.
And does it not start to sag?
If it's in the air, it will. If it's on the bed, it won't.
How could it not be on the bed? Or excuse me, how could it?
Again, I built that with the supports. So it's building up a structure under it.
Okay, so on this one, you cut the supports off already?
Yes, you can see where it's rough.
I'm with what?
Compared to the top side.
Do you think a prop would hold up?
I tried a prop, it didn't come out very good, but what I did was take an 8-inch prop and shrink it down to a 5-inch, and it got too thin. But I think getting the supports off, you destroy it.
It looked kind of rough.
Yeah, it's not good. I should have brought one. I don't think I did. Nope, didn't bring a prop. It was rough. Okay, so now it's printing the quad arm. If you want to look at it, you'll see how it starts. It actually does an outline, puts the holes down, and then he's going to go back and start filling it in.
I did a 3D soldier on mine standing up on time.
Yeah.
And it was intricate because it had the legs and the arms and a weapon and everything all standing out from the guy.
Yeah.
And of course, it does it from the bottom all the way up. So you can imagine this guy's growing from the base up. And all these things are sticking out as he's growing farther and farther. And there's stuff sticking out into the air out here. You know, right? He's got a sword. The sword sticking out into the air. And the first 4 or 5 times I did it, stuff was changing over,
yeah,
falling off, and everything else. So I finally told him to turn on the supports.
Then you could do it.
So when I did it then, it had supports and strings, and it had a whole encasement around this guy. When it got done, it took me an hour to cut off.
Yeah, it's scary when it does the supports.
So the supports is a function that you push a button in.
Anytime you have something suspended in air, you have to have a support, because when he lays plastic, it'll fall down.
Yeah. But the program knows how to add the support?
Yeah, you just tell it you want supports.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe you had to design support.
No, you just tell it.
But in this case,
it's all built in.
It created a three-sided encasement all the way around the,
yeah,
yeah, yeah,
and there was strings going over to all the things that it had to support.
It's
yeah.
I say it looks like corrugated cardboard inside is what the supports look like. Yeah, so anytime you have something suspended in air, you have to have a support.
Right.
Like when I printed this, you know, he's got a big opening there, but that was going vertically, so he was fine with that.
So what is,
but if this is one piece, you'd have a problem.
What's
with that
the
top.
Best way to trim those supports? Dremel or
whatever you can. Yeah, Dremel. I use wire cutters and files and all kind of stuff.
Well, that's what I'm asking. Like, are the supports? And maybe this is a stupid question. But are the supports like really thin, or do they end up kind of thick?
They're kind of thin, but they stick. There's a lot of them, and they stick really well.
I see.
Like I said, on ABS, they just kind of rip off.
ABS, you just rip them off.
Yeah, they just come right off.
So,
but PLA, they don't.
Utility knife would kind of get it.
You can use an X-Acto.
It end up working on it for a while.
Yeah, you'll be a while.
On this army guy that I did, there's ripped off all the support.